Good evening. We are the Encore String Quartet, and we are delighted to see you all here this evening. And we are delighted to bring you a very special program with a very special guest who has come with us all the way from Germany. We are joined by Melinda Paulsen, mezzo-soprano, who is on the voice faculty at the University of Music and Performing Arts in Frankfurt, Germany. Melinda and I are from the same hometown. We sang in middle school choir, we played string quartets together, and I ended up marrying her brother.
Very good choice.
You know how it goes. But we grew apart. She moved to Germany, she's lived there for 30 years, I moved to Madison, I've been here for 18 years, we pursued our separate careers, and yet we remained in touch and had the idea about 2 years ago, what would it be like to collaborate musically once more? So I presented this idea to the string quartet, and they were interested enough to pursue it. It seemed like a better idea the more we thought about it, and we ended up putting together a tour program. Melinda researched the available repertoire for mezzo-soprano and string quartet, and out of that list, we chose a program of pieces by German and American composers, which we call German-American Dreams. She will explain to you more about that. We had the thrill of performing it in Germany. We were there for 10 days. We performed five times in five different cities and towns. It was fabulous. And then we came back bringing Melinda with us, and we are just finishing up a blitz, 6 days, seven performances, including an appearance on Wisconsin Public Radio being interviewed by Norman Gilliland for the midday. We played in cities, Germantown, Janesville, Beloit, what am I leaving out? Whitewater, and we're ending here tonight. And it's going to be very strange to wake up tomorrow and not think, where are we performing tonight? It's been a great tour. We're already planning future collaborations, so we will keep you posted as that matures. Melinda and the quartet are very grateful for the support we've received from two organizations here in Wisconsin, the Wisconsin-Hessen Sister State Society and the Kassel-Dane County Sister County Task Force. People from these organizations helped us line up performances in Germany, and they helped line up funding for our travel in Germany, and we express our heartfelt appreciation to them all. Melinda will tell you a little bit more about each piece. Please help me welcome her to the front of the stage.
Thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here. It's a wonderful space. Now, why German-American Dreams? I'll get to that. But first, I think you need to know that this is music that rarely makes its way into concert programs. In this particular program, we've combined works that are well known in their respective countries, for example, Wagner's Wesendonck settings, which are often done in Germany, and Barber's Adagio for Strings, as one of the most well-known classical works in America. We're combining them with works which, through no fault of their own, have not really made it into the spotlight. Hindemith, for example, is well known for his opera Matisse der Mahler and for some of his instrumental chamber music, but who knows melancholy? Victor Ullmann had almost disappeared from the public eye. Now he's beginning to see a kind of a renaissance through his opera Der Kaiser von Atlantis, and some of his songs are being performed more often, of which I'm very glad. And Barber's Dover Beach is, first of all, rarely performed, and second, if you hear a performance, it won't necessarily be with a mezzo-soprano. So, this is all wonderful, expressive music. But the common denominator, it turned out that the common denominator for this program is that many of the texts refer to dreams or visions. Each composer has found his own way to set these pictures into music, to find musical qualities to express yearning, fear, ecstasy, or reconciliation, to name a few of the emotions that we will encounter. We are aware that this is a very intense program and that it demands a lot of attention from its audience, but all we can say is it's worth it. Dover Beach. This is an early work by Barber. He wrote it in 1931. He sets a somewhat cumbersome text by Matthew Arnold to music and uses open intervals in the strings to suggest loneliness. A pulsating figure describes the ebbing and flowing of the water in the Straits of Dover by night. In the middle, when the poet becomes philosophical, there's even a short phase where all melody stops and the music becomes almost conversational, as in operatic recitatives, before the water motif resumes and tension begins to build up to the poet's anguished cry, "Love, let us be true to one another." Barber then finds chilling material for the final lines of the poem, which are very famous and are cited often, where on a darkling plain, ignorant armies clash by night. Samuel Barber, Dover Beach.
Thank you.
begun a downward spiral into darkness, for which I might apologize if I can promise you this. The Barber Quartet, after the intermission, brings us right back up into the light. But we'll take the next step now to Victor Ullmann. Ullmann studied composition in Vienna with Arnold Schoenberg as a young man before he moved to Prague to continue his studies with Alexander von Zemlinsky. He spent most of his short life in Prague, working as a composer, a music teacher, and as a journalist. In 1939, the Nazis forbade the performance of music by composers of Jewish descent in Prague, and not only in Prague. Victor Ullmann's fate was sealed in 1942. He was arrested and sent to the concentration camp in Theresienstadt. In 1944, he was deported from Theresienstadt to Auschwitz and was killed there. Thinking about the circumstances under which he was composing, it is surprising that he was such a prolific composer. Unfortunately, few of his works survived the war. The three songs you will hear tonight were composed in Theresienstadt. Only a fragment of the second song, Erwachen zu Weihnachten, Awakening at Christmas, could be recovered. In the third song, we experience the ending of the year, autumn, with the fruits of the harvest and with migrating birds as the only companions of a lonely person. The golden time of love gives way to peace and to silence. Victor Ullmann, three songs.
Thank you.
spent many years of his life there before he was forced to go into exile in Switzerland in 1938. Eventually, he moved to America and became a professor at Yale. In this cycle, Melancholie, Hindemith sets texts by the famous German poet Christian Morgenstern. Hindemith wrote the cycle between 1917 and 1919 and dedicated the work to his friend Karl Perler, who was killed in World War I. Both the choice of texts for the cycle and the relatively provocative musical material Hindemith uses to set the texts reflect the horrors he himself experienced in the First World War. In the first song, someone tries to persuade another person to see the beauty all around them. The song ends with the second person's remark, "I have known much sorrow." The second song sets a text that is more typical for Christian Morgenstern. He's quite well known for his absurd, slightly abstract, and a little strange poems. And the second song is about a fog weaver and what happens between him and his wife. The third song, though, lets us stare in fascination at a drop of death falling into a goblet of life or a goblet of joy. And with the last song, there we start to come back up to the surface. It's called Traumwald, or Dream Forest. And there Hindemith opens up a door behind him, a door that leads back to the late Romantic tradition into which he was born. I feel like he's giving us just a little bit of solace after all the turmoil in the first three songs. He lets us bathe in the beauty of the natural world one last time with bird song at night and a choir of stars. You'll hear many beautiful musical moments in the viola line in these songs by Hindemith. He himself was a very accomplished violist, and he played the premier performance of Melancholie in 1919 in Frankfurt with his own string quartet. Paul Hindemith, Melancholie.
Und grüßt und so nie. Le trompe hier mir heut in den Becher fiel, in den Becher des Lebens. Dunkle Tropfen
Du
dunkle Tropfe.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Wes Luke. I play first violin in the Encore String Quartet, and I was selected to say words to you about the Barber String Quartet before we play it for you. Before I do that, I wanted to take this one last opportunity that I have in public to thank Melinda Paulsen for joining us for this tour. It's been, I mean, my God, she's so good, right? It's been such an inspiration. But, I didn't know, I should have looked up when we agreed to do this project. I should have just gone on iTunes and like downloaded her many professional recordings, which I urge you to as well. But I didn't. I didn't even know what we were doing until we got to Germany and I heard her sing for the first time and I said, wow, that's awesome. There's so much control of that instrument. It's just, I've learned so much over these last few weeks about so many things, but I just appreciate so much. I know, and everyone else, we all had to make a lot of sacrifices to make this whole project happen. We got a lot of money from these cultural organizations that Marika mentioned, and you know, when people start giving you money, you start thinking, I hope it's good. But we've been able to play for hundreds of people throughout Wisconsin who have gotten to hear Melinda sing and would have not had that opportunity otherwise, so it's been a genuine cultural exchange from Germany to here. And one thing that we wanted to do as part of our cultural exchange in Germany was bring the Barber String Quartet, largely because of the second movement of the Barber String Quartet, which is the famous Adagio for Strings by Barber. Now, I see a lot of you nodding, so you already know what this is and what it's about, but I'm going to mention a few words about it anyway. The Adagio for Strings by Barber is among, if not the most famous piece of American classical music among Americans. And it's more famous in the arrangement for string orchestra that Barber did just a couple years after he wrote the quartet on the request of Toscanini, who premiered it, and it immediately went into the standard repertoire of every orchestra in the world, but especially American orchestras. And in America, the piece has become a kind of icon of our moments of national mourning. On the death of FDR, famously, Koussevitzky stopped a Boston Symphony performance and passed out parts to the Barber Adagio, and it was played on the radio live in the announcement of FDR's death. At the death of John F. Kennedy, it was a televised performance of the piece on 9/11, and many of you probably remember that many American orchestras, and actually orchestras around the world, performed the piece that day. Anecdotally, we played this on the radio on Wednesday, and my dad texted me right afterwards, and he said, I just wanted to remind you that that's what I would like at my funeral as well. So it has this deeply American character to it. We in the United States relate to the music on a deeper level than internationally. It's not that it's not known. It is a well-known piece internationally, but it's a special piece for Americans. However, the whole string quartet in which the piece was originally conceived is not heard that often. It's not heard that often in the United States. There aren't that many recordings of it, and it's heard far less in Germany. So we thought it would be really interesting for everybody to just hear the whole piece the way it was originally conceived. And it may surprise you a bit, because the music in the outer movements, it's a three-movement piece. The middle movement is the famous Adagio, but the first and third movements have the same music, and it's music of panic and ambivalence and a nervous energy and exactly the kind of things that you might associate with a kind of like triggering event that would generate the kind of pathos that we all know in the Adagio for Strings. If you don't know the Adagio for Strings, you'll recognize it immediately once we start it. And I think it'll be fascinating for you to hear the whole original concept of the piece, the way that Barber conceived it. Here's Barber's string quartet. Thank you.
composer and his muse, his inspiration. Matilda's husband, Otto Wiesendorf, was a generous sponsor and supporter of Wagner during Wagner's exile in Zurich. It seems as if Matilda, who was 20 years younger than Wagner, served as a kind of a screen upon which Wagner could project all his theories of self-abandonment and anguished love. The texts that Matilda wrote for Wagner are full of, shall we say, steamy pathos. And for German ears, it sometimes grates. A little bit of fingernails on the blackboard. When she rhymes träume, dreams, with schäume, foam, you will find some people wince in the audience. But she really poured her heart out in these poems, and it seems to me that they are almost more rooted in Wagner's exalted realm than his music is. Wagner wrote the cycle as songs with piano accompaniment. He transcribed the last song, Träume, Dreams, for solo violin and orchestra himself. But the well-known versions of the cycle with orchestral accompaniment were written by others. This version for string quartet and mezzo-soprano was arranged by the German composer Stefan Heucke. The cycle was premiered in Germany in 2017, and its US premiere was on September 4th, here in Madison, in Capitol Lakes. And just so you can get a sense of the time that these people were living in, Mathilde Wiesendonck is a fairly famous for these texts, let's put it that way, but her name was not Mathilde. Her name was Agnes Wiesendonck. But when she met Otto Wiesendonck, he demanded that she change her name to Mathilde before he married her. And that was the name of his deceased first wife. Yes. Richard Wagner, the Wiesendonck songs.
Thank you. Thank you.
nicht wie